Welcome back to video series on liver function test. This is the third video and today I am going to explain bilirubin and bile salts. In the last video we learned classification of liver function test. So today I am going to explain test based on excretory functions of the liver, that is mainly serum bilirubin and urine urobilinogen bile salts. Just before going to liver function test based on excretory functions of the liver, so I am going to explain very fast about the metabolism of bilirubin or formation of bilirubin and degradation of bilirubin. I already made a video on this. I will put the link in the description box below. Just I am going to summarize everything within 5 minutes. As we know, RBC, the lifespan of red blood cells, is 120 days. After 120 days, they undergo hemolysis and liberate heme and globin. So this heme converted to unconjugated bilirubin in the reticuloendothelial system, and which will be transported to the liver through the circulation with the help of albumin. And this unconjugated bilirubin conjugated in the liver to conjugated bilirubin. And this conjugated bilirubin along with bile salts, we call it as bile, stored in the gallbladder. And from this gallbladder, it will be released to small intestine, in fact to the duodenum, through common bile duct. This common bile duct also takes pancreatic enzymes and juice, I have not shown here. And once it reaches small intestine, especially duodenum, the normal bacterial flora present in the small intestine converts this conjugated bilirubin to urobilinogen. Majority of this urobilinogen, about 80 to 90% of this urobilinogen, converted to stercobilinogen and excreted as stercobilin in the feces. A small portion, that is 10 to 20% of urobilinogen, again reabsorbed back to liver through portal circulation. So this reabsorption of urobilinogen is called enterohepatic circulation. Small portion of this reabsorbed urobilinogen enters systemic circulation and reaches kidney and excreted in the urine as urobilin. Okay, this physiology you need to understand in order to diagnose various hepatobiliary disorders by doing liver function test. So now we have bilirubin present in the blood, urobilin in the urine, stercobilin in the stool or feces. So we can do investigations based on excretory functions of the liver. That is, through we can take collect blood sample and we can do LFT. Also, we can collect urine and do so many tests. Very rarely, we can collect stool or feces and we can estimate stercobilin. So, the most common test based on excretory functions of the liver when you collect blood is total bilirubin. So, when I say total bilirubin, it includes conjugated as well as unconjugated bilirubin. Normally its level should be less than 1 mg per deciliter of sample. And again, the direct bilirubin, also called conjugated bilirubin, the normal level is 0.1 to 0.4 mg per deciliter, whereas unconjugated bilirubin, it is also called indirect bilirubin, the normal level is 0.2 to 0.7 mg per deciliter. Okay, this is investigation based on excretory functions of the liver done on the serum or the blood sample. We can also do LFT by collecting urine. Normally, we have traces of urobilinogen or urobilin in our urine. Very less quantity. The whole day or for 24 hours, it is about 0.4 mg. And you must remember, we will not see bilirubin and bile salts in normal individuals. So whenever bilirubin and bile salts present in the urine, that means it is pathological. And in the stool, Routinely, we will not do this test, but to understand the physiology of bilirubin metabolism and liver function test, just I have mentioned here, the amount of stercobilin excreted in the feces per day is about 40 to 280 milligram. So based on these investigations, you should know two terminology. One is hyperbilirubinemia, another one is jaundice. Whenever there is the total serum bilirubin level exceeds 1 milligram per deciliter, we call hyperbilirubinemia. And this level, when it exceeds more than 2.5 milligram per deciliter or 2 to 3 milligram per deciliter, then we use term jaundice. So that means jaundice is nothing but yellowish discoloration of the skin, mucous membrane, tongue and sclera. Usually, whenever there is hyperbilirubinemia, patient need not present with the jaundice because the coloration or yellowish discoloration will take place only when hyperbilirubinemia exceeds more than 2.5 milligram per deciliter. So that this colored pigment will diffuse into the soft tissue and we can see yellowish discoloration of the skin, mucous membrane, tongue and sclera. Now this hyperbilirubinemia or jaundice could be due to three reasons. First and foremost, we know this bilirubin is formed from hemolysis, that means breakdown of RBC. So whenever there is excess breakdown of RBC or we call excessive hemolysis, then we can have lot of unconjugated bilirubin and there will be jaundice or hyperbilirubinemia. As seen in malaria, sickle cell hemoglobin, thalassemia, spirocytosis, glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. So all these disorders or diseases, there will be excessive breakdown of RBC or hemolysis. So there will be lot of unconjugated bilirubin accumulated in the circulation. So this is called prehepatic jaundice or hemolytic jaundice. That means the reasons or causes are before the conjugation in the liver. So liver is fine here. The next type of hyperbilirubinemia or jaundice is due to any pathology in the liver itself. There may be damage to the hepatic parenchymal cells or there may be a obstruction, that is intrahepatic obstruction in the microbiliary tree due to viral hepatitis, alcoholic hepatitis or poisonings or drugs, cirrhosis of the liver, all these conditions, there will be a jaundice and this type of jaundice is called hepatic jaundice or hepatocellular jaundice. The last type of jaundice or the reason for hyperbilirubinemia is due to obstruction to the flow of bile from the gallbladder to the small intestine. This may be due to the impacted gallstones within the gallbladder or there may be obstruction to the common bile duct by malignancy of the head of the pancreas or the common bile duct itself. So this obstruction prevents smooth passage of bile from the gallbladder to the small intestine. So this type of jaundice is called post-hepatic or obstructive jaundice. It is also known as extrahepatic obstruction. And this obstruction may be within the liver, then it will come to intrahepatic obstruction or hepatocellular jaundice. So now we know the three main reasons, hemolysis or unable to conjugate within the liver or there may be a obstruction. Based on these three reasons, we classify jaundice into prehepatic, hepatic, posthepatic. Prehepatic also called hemolytic, hepatic also called hepatocellular, posthepatic also known as obstructive jaundice. So far we have learnt these are the parameters usually we do in liver function test based on excretory functions of the liver. From the blood, total bilirubin, conjugated and unconjugated bilirubin. And from the urine sample, we can detect urine urobilin, bile salts, and in the stool, stercobilin. We will compare these investigation in three types of jaundice. First, we will take prehepatic jaundice or hemolytic jaundice, where normal conjugated or direct bilirubin. Because in prehepatic or hemolytic jaundice, liver is normal, so it can conjugate beyond its capacity. But in hemolytic or prehepatic jaundice, there is gross increase in unconjugated bilirubin because liver has its own capacity. It cannot conjugate all unconjugated bilirubin formed by hemolysis. So in the circulation, there is keep on accumulation of this unconjugated bilirubin. Unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia is the hallmark of prehepatic jaundice. And normally there is no bilirubin in the urine, and in prehepatic jaundice also there is no bilirubin in the urine. Whereas urine urobilin increase because liver works beyond its capacity. It conjugates more unconjugated bilirubin because of excessive hemolysis. There is no bile salts in prehepatic jaundice as same that of normal individual. Thesis, there is increase in the stercobilin because more conjugated bilirubin entering the small intestine. Coming to hepatic jaundice or hepatocellular jaundice, because of intrahepatic obstruction or whenever there is cirrhosis or viral hepatitis, some hepatic parenchymal cells are damaged and these cells block the microbiliary canaliculi or microbiliary tree within the liver. So, even though some cells are normal, they can conjugate unconjugated bilirubin to conjugated bilirubin, they cannot enter the gallbladder because of this clogging by damaged hepatic parenchymal cells. So, this conjugated bilirubin regurgitated back to circulation and we would see increased serum conjugated bilirubin in hepatic jaundice. Not only serum conjugated bilirubin elevation, but we also see increase in serum unconjugated bilirubin because there is damage in the liver due to viral hepatitis or alcoholic hepatitis or cirrhosis of the liver. So, liver cannot conjugate all unconjugated bilirubin. So, in the circulation, there is elevation of unconjugated bilirubin also. So, you must remember elevation of both conjugated bilirubin and unconjugated bilirubin is the feature of hepatocellular jaundice. Depending upon intrahepatic obstruction, we also find bilirubin in the urine. Normally, we won't see bilirubin in the urine. But because of obstruction within the liver, we will see bilirubin in the urine. Urobilin in the urine is going to decrease. Again, this feature depends upon the extent of liver cell damage and intrahepatic obstruction. So, normally there will be decrease in the urobilin. And there is increase in the urine bile salts. Again, because of obstruction within the liver, bile salts are regurgitated back to circulation and it will be filtered in the kidney and we are going to find bile salts in hepatic jaundice. Normally, we won't see bile salts in the urine. For the same reason, that is intrahepatic obstruction, we are going to see decreased stercobilin in the feces. So, these are the features of hepatocellular jaundice. Coming to post-hepatic or obstructive jaundice, increase conjugated bilirubin or conjugated hyperbilirubinemia is the hallmark of post-hepatic or extrahepatic obstructive jaundice. Invariably, we will see normal unconjugated bilirubin because there is no excessive hemolysis and there is no pathology lies within the liver. And we are going to see more bilirubin in the urine. There is no urobilin in the urine and we are going to see bile salts in the urine in obstructive jaundice also. Coming to fecal stercobilin. There is no fecal stercobilin in post-hepatic jaundice. So you must remember, there is unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia in pre-hepatic jaundice, conjugated hyperbilirubinemia in post-hepatic jaundice, whereas in hepatic jaundice, both conjugated and unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So normally we will not see bilirubin in the urine. If bilirubin is present in the urine, that might be due to post-hepatic or hepatic. Normally we won't see bile salts in the urine. If we find bile salts in the urine, then it might be due to obstructive, that is hepatic or post-hepatic jaundice. These are the liver function tests based on excretory functions of the liver. So we can differentiate these three type of jaundice based on other tests also. Based on enzymes also we can differentiate these three type of jaundice. I am going to explain in future videos. So in the next video, I am going to explain test based on synthetic functions of the liver, that is plasma proteins and prothrombin time. Thanks for watching.